We are blessed to be here tonight, and we're blessed to be alive in our Lord Jesus, to be here to come and share and come and serve. Hello, Sister Joy. To come and give what the Lord has given to us. And it's our desire, hello, Brother Mark. It's our desire that we get closer with the Lord Jesus tonight. That we go away from here and truly be blessed. And I want to greet you all in the wonderful name of the Lord Jesus. And I want to bless you in the name of Jesus. And say, brothers and sisters, I pray that you be truly blessed tonight by the power of our Lord Jesus and by His Spirit that He gave to us to be with us. Because God is Spirit, and we must worship Him in spirit and in truth, from the heart, from inside of here, not from here. Many people worship the Lord from the head, and they try and serve Him with the head. We got to serve Him with the heart. And you know, there are some things that you cannot say with your mind. It just your words do not reach that far. There are some feelings, some yearnings in us that words cannot express. That is what I want to talk about tonight. I was praying and the Lord laid it on my heart tonight that we've got to yearn for the Holy Spirit. We've got to yearn for Jesus. We've got to yearn for God. We've got to have that desire, that our soul pants for the Lord. As King David wrote in Psalm 42, he says, "My like the deer panteth for the water." He says, "My soul pants for thee, O Lord." Psalm 42, verse 1, he says, As a hart panteth after the water brook, so panteth my soul after thee, O Lord. My soul thirsteth, O God, for the living God. When shall I appear before God? King David yearns for the Lord, and he's crying out to God. He says, Lord, I yearn for thee. You know, sometimes we pray and we just don't know what to pray. And inside of us there's just that big, almost an emptiness. It's like a big pain, like something that is amiss. And then we can cry out to the Lord. And many people have not learned to cry out to the Lord and to just yearn for Him, to fill that gap, to come in and fill that thirsting in their soul. And dear friends, we've got to do that, because without the Spirit of God, we are incomplete. We need the Spirit of the living God. It was on our Wednesday night fellowship that the Lord really opened something up for me, and that is when Sister Joy mentioned here the outpouring of the Holy Spirit that must still come. And you know, right there, the Holy Spirit spoke to me and said to me, it is the mistake or the problem lies not with God. It lies with us. God wants to pour out His Spirit on His people. He wants to give us the Holy Spirit. He wants to fill us He wants to satisfy our souls with His goodness, with His Spirit. But there's no yearning. People are not seeking the Holy Spirit. God has poured out His Spirit once on the day of Pentecost. And He wishes to fill us with streams of living water, as Jesus also promised the woman at the well. He said to her, if you knew who it was that you are asking, is asking you for water, then you would ask him, and he would give you streams of living water. And dear friends, we need streams of living water. Without the Spirit of God, we can do nothing. Jesus said, without me, you can do nothing. Too many people, their spiritual exercise, their spirituality, their religion, call it what you may, is just a head exercise. They say they believe, but it hasn't gone down to the heart. It sits in the head. And it's an exercise of cause and effect. You've got to go through the steps, A, B, C, or 1, 2, 3, and now they are saved. And dear friends, we need to yearn with everything that is in us for the Spirit of God to come and inhabit us, to come and dwell in us, so that we can have streams of living water flowing through us. We are in a spiritual warfare day by day, and we cannot win that war, that battle, with our minds. We can only win if we are led by the Spirit of God. We need to have that implanted Word of God, the implanted wisdom of God in our hearts, to be part of it, us, not into our head, but into our heart, that knowledge, that knowing. You haven't heard it, you just know it. You just know. It's like you know I am my Father's child. Nobody taught you that. You just know I'm my Father's child. When God puts His Spirit into us, He puts knowledge into us. He puts that know, to know, that implanted word He puts in us, the Spirit of God. Jesus comes and He dwells in us. The Father comes and He dwells in us. And Jesus said, when they bring you in front of synagogues and when they persecute you, don't be concerned. Don't worry what you're going to say. Because in that moment, it will be given to you what to say. Why? The Father who dwells in you, it is Him who speaks through you. We need that inner penetration of the Holy Spirit in our spirit. We need the Spirit of God. As Paul said, that if we do not have the Spirit of God, we do not belong to Him. Friends, it is a spiritual relationship, and it can only be kept alive if we connect it to the Lord through the Holy Spirit in prayer. But we have to have that yearning. We gotta seek the Lord with all our heart. We gotta cry out to Him, yearn for Him every moment. Seek the Lord. People say, yeah, somebody wrote me tonight, he says, I've stopped sinning, I've stopped doing this, I've done that, and all the other, he says, but I'm not receiving the Holy Spirit, so I'm not worthy. It's not a matter of being worthy. It's a matter of hunger and thirsting, of yearning. Jesus said, blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, because they will be satisfied. We've got to hunger and thirst for God. We've got to hunger and thirst for the Holy Spirit of God. There's got to be that constant yearning for the Spirit of God. And then He will fill us. He will fill us with His presence and with Himself, so that we are one with Him and that Jesus can be seen in us. You see, as long as we are playing this tag war, you know, pulling this way and that way, we won't get anywhere. But we have to fully immerse ourselves and into the Spirit of God and just say, Lord, just fill me up, please. Fill me up to overflow. You know, one psalm he says, open your mouth wide that I can fill it. Open your mouth wide. Now, you know, the reason why many people do not get praying in tongues is they are so inhibited. You know, they are worried they're going to say something wrong. Something's wrong is going to come out. Nothing wrong can come out. When I'm in the presence of God, He knows everything about me. There's nothing He doesn't know. He knows my thoughts. He knows my desires. It is just about being with the Father. And many people don't spend that time with the Father. They don't go and pray and just say, Lord, I just want to be with You. Father, I just want to be pleasing to Thee. Now, people have often got this idea that God is walking around with a big stick and looking for a reason to get at us. Friends, God loves us, and He wants us to come closer to Him, to come be with Him. He wants to dwell in us and be with us, His Spirit in us. Jesus said, the one who loves me is the one who keeps my words. And me and my Father, we will come and dwell with Him, come and live with us. And we get the mind of Christ. You know what your Father wants. You just know it. You don't need to go and study it. You know. You know what Father wants, and you know what Father does not approve of. But you see, people are not sensitive to the Holy Spirit. They don't care what God thinks. They want to see with how much they can get away. You know, like a naughty child, he just wants to see how far he can push the envelope. As obedient children of God, we're not pushing the envelope. We're seeking to be pleasing to the Father all the time. We are here to do His will. That is why Jesus came. He said, I've come to do Thy will, O God. He came to do what the Father wanted Him to do, to be pleasing to the Father. And that is what we need to be yearning after, is for the approval of the Father. Many people are looking for fellowship, you know. They say, oh, I'm looking for Christian fellowship. I'm looking for brothers and sisters, you know. What we should be doing is treasuring the Father's fellowship, and bringing others into the fellowship that we have with the Father through Jesus. And then we have fellowship with each other. Because you say to another person, my friend, I want to introduce you to Jesus. I want to bring you into the Father's house so that you can be a child of God, so that you can also have what I have. What have I got? I've got the company of the Father. I am approved by my Father. I'm treasured by Him, and I do what is pleasing in His sight. And I have His approval. You know, when you have the peace of God in you, it is something that money cannot buy. I'm reminded of this woman who went to a prison to go and give a testimony to the inmates there. And there was a guy there that was so full of the peace and the joy of the Lord. This person was in prison. He was an inmate. He had been put in prison for some misdemeanor. But there he found Jesus. And although he was in prison, couldn't go out and go where he wanted to go, he was free inside. Because Jesus had came into his life and made him free. And he had a joy and a peace about him that was envied by other people. I say, wow, what is that guy got? He's got so much peace. He's got so much joy in him. He's got no worry in the world. And that is what Jesus said. He said, do not be concerned about anything. Because tomorrow, he says, don't worry about tomorrow. Tomorrow will have enough of its own troubles. Imagine Abraham. The Lord tells him to go and sacrifice his son. said to him, go and sacrifice Isaac. And now he takes his son, and he's got the knife, and he's got the fire, and now they're going to sacrifice. And now his little boy says to me, he says, Dad, he says, we have the knife, we have the fire, now where's the lamb? So what does Abraham say to his son? He knows he's going to sacrifice his son, because God said to him, take Isaac, the one whom you love, and go and sacrifice him for me. What does he say? He says, well, we will see. No, he says, God will supply. God will supply. And you know, we've got to be so sure of Father that we say, God will supply. Because he will supply. Dear friends, God has never let us down. He's never let me down. I'll tell you, I've had some very hairy times in my life where I've been so worried, you know. I was sweating profusely, man. I say, oh Lord, what now? You know, I say, man, Lord, I'm in despair. And you know, and the Lord just put me through it. He took me through it. I remember one day, man, I got some news, and it wasn't good. It was from the receiver of revenue many years ago. And man, I said, Lord, what am I going to do with this? But I'll tell you, I was in a cold sweat in seconds, man. I was wet. And God got me out of it. That's another story. But, you know, the thing is that God is a God of miracles. God is a God of the impossible. He takes us on the impossible roads, and he delivers us from every trouble. We know how to get into trouble. We know how to go astray. But you know, God is good, and God is our Father, and he will not desert us. If you're a child of God, you're a child of God. And his intentions with you are only good. Nothing bad. You know, people are worried. They say, if I follow Jesus, you know, maybe God will send me where I don't want to go. Maybe things will happen that I don't want. You know, maybe he gives me the wrong wife. You know, maybe she's ugly or something. You know, these young guys, you know. Or maybe he gives me the wrong husband, you know. Or maybe he sends me to Timbuktu. Friends, God's intentions with us are only good. His plans are wonderful, but his plans are about his kingdom. And he is ready to prove himself as a faithful Father, but we need to trust him. We need to completely trust him. And you only see the hand of God moving when you obey it. When he calls you and you answer, you say, yes, Lord, I'm coming. But when he calls you and he tells you to do something, you say, oh, well, I'm going to think about this. You've got a problem. But God is good. He's good all the time. Friends, he cares for us. And he will not let us down, not one single moment. You know, God is a God that cares so much for us that if we go wrong, he's going to discipline us. He'll not let you get away with it. Not with one single thing. You know, my dad was a good man. A very good man. And sometimes I got away with, with wrong things. The old man didn't catch me out, you know. And I sometimes did things that I shouldn't have done, but, you know, if the old man caught you out, you knew you were in for trouble. But sometimes Dad, you know, he didn't pick up on it. But God is not like that. There is not one single disobedience, not one single sin that God does not know about and that he does not pick up on. He knows about it. And you're not going to get away with it. If you do not repent, he's going to punish you. He's going to chastise you. Why? Because he cares for you. He wants to fix you up. And he's going to fix you up. He's going to straighten you out. But we got to submit to God. Or else, we we become reprobates. You know, and then God leaves us to ourselves. And we will not enter the kingdom of God. You know, God does that. If we're not really interested, He says, well, have your way. You know, we read in Romans chapter 1, Paul says there that because they did not regard God, they didn't take Him seriously, He delivered them to their own desires, to do what is wrong. If we continue in our wrong ways, and if we continuously want wrong things, God will give it to us. He will never stop us. If it's your desire to go and do filth, to go fornicate or adulterate or whatever, God will let you go. You get a hiding. If you're a child of God, you're going to get a hiding because He cares for you. But if you persist in it, He's not going to hold you back. And in the end, you'll end up with the children of disobedience. But the wonderful thing is that God cares for us. And He disciplines His children because He wants them to share in His holiness. And God's discipline is on many children of His right now. Many children of God are being severely disciplined. They are being chastised. They are struck with sickness, with disasters. Things going wrong in their lives. Everything is going wrong. Why is it? Because God cares for them. You know, Paul wrote in Corinthians about a certain man that was into severe immorality. And Paul said that when he comes, and him with the Spirit of God will deliver that person to Satan for the destruction of his body so that his soul can be saved. What did he mean by that? You know, God keeps the devil away from us. He protects us. But there comes a day when God delivers us to the punishers. He says, man, this guy doesn't want to listen. And he says, okay, you go fix him up. And he hands you over to the devil so that the devil can rough you up. Why? So that you can learn to repent. And the hope is that we repent, that we turn away from wickedness, and that we start following the Lord, start seeking the Lord. Why is it? Because God is good, friends. And because God wants to give us the very best. But you know, people desire evil. And I see this every day with the comments of people on, you know, on the internet here. They say they cannot stop sinning. And these apostate churches, they teach the people that you cannot stop sinning. Why is that? Because they've never repented. They've never met Jesus. They've never been born again. They don't have the Holy Spirit of God. If you meet with God, then you're done with sin. Then you know. The wages of sin is death. And it is by the grace of God that He saved me, that Jesus has saved me, and I must make use of that grace of God. And you see, people are into this academic exercise that they are told that, oh, well, if you just confess Jesus with your mouth, you know, and you say the sinner's prayer, you're saved. You're not. Unless you have repented and truly turned away from sin and purified yourself and you've been born again of water to wash off the sin and of the Spirit of God to fill you in with His Spirit. If that doesn't happen, you're not a child of God. If we do not have the Spirit of God, we don't belong to Him. And you know, many people just don't want the Spirit of God. They want the filth. You know, they are continuously looking over the fence. They are longing back for the flesh pots of Egypt, like the Jews did. God took them out of bondage. He took them through the Red Sea, took them into the desert. He miraculously fed them on manna in the desert. Every day they got manna and quails. He gave them water from the rock. He protected them by day and night. They had no need. They were under the protection of God. They were in His mighty hand. But man, They kept on moaning and whining and complaining, and they just longed back for Egypt, for the flesh pots. And they annoyed God so much that He struck them down in the desert. He killed them. That whole generation died in the desert. Only Joshua and Caleb and their children went into the promised land. There are so many believers today who will not enter the kingdom of heaven because they keep on longing back for the flesh pots of Egypt. Man, they are into the world. They just want to watch the movies. They just want to do what the world does. They love the world and the things of the world, and they don't care for God. They don't want the Holy Spirit. They got a self-made religion that they are carrying on. They couldn't care for the Spirit of God because they're okay. They got things their way. And they believe they're saved, but they're not. They don't have the Spirit of God. They don't have a desire for God, and God knows it. And they will not go into the kingdom of heaven. They don't have the Holy Spirit. And you know, dear friends, there are people that are coming in from the outside that have never been in a church, and they desire Jesus. They want the Holy Spirit. They want to be baptized in water. They want the baptism of the Holy Spirit. And these apostate Christians, they give you verses and quote you verses and tell you why they should not speak in tongues, why the gifts of the Holy Spirit are not for them. They just don't want it. But these newcomers, they want it. I say, give everything. Lord, I want everything you want to give me. I hunger and I thirst. They will be saved. Jesus said, He said, the harlots and the publicans, they go ahead of you into the kingdom of God. Because He says, when John the Baptist came, He says, hey, listen. And they repented. And the Pharisees, they didn't repent. And today the Pharisees are not repenting. They think because they're sitting in a church and because they know the Bible that they're saved, and they're not repenting of their sin. They're living in sin and iniquity. They don't want the Holy Spirit of God. And they think they're saved. They're not. They don't have anything to do with Jesus. And it is to them that Jesus will say in that day, go away, I never knew you. They don't have that yearning, that desire for the Holy Spirit of God to say, Lord, just fill me up. Lord, I don't care what it takes. I don't care what the world says. I don't care whether the whole world thinks I'm as crazy as a nut. I don't care. I just want Jesus. That's all I want. I don't want to think. I don't want to be rational. I want to be pleasing to God. If we don't have that desire in us, and that attitude that I don't care what the world thinks, I don't care whether my family reject me or the world rejects me or everybody thinks I'm crazy, I couldn't care about it. If we don't have that attitude and we don't desire the Lord above everything, then we won't go into His kingdom. He won't give us His Spirit. Friends, we got to have that desire for the Spirit of God. We've got to spend time waiting on the Lord, and He will fill us. You know, when Jesus ascended to heaven, He said to those disciples, go to Jerusalem and wait for what is promised, the Holy Spirit. What did they do? They went to Jerusalem and they waited there. And they were of one accord, man. They were praying. They were praying. They were waiting on the Lord. And what happened? Holy Spirit came down on them. Why? They had prepared hearts. They were not in sin. They were not looking out on the streets, looking window shopping and looking for the things of the world. You know? They didn't say, oh, well, now the Master is gone. Now we can go back to where we were. No. They were waiting on the Holy Spirit. They were yearning. And what happened? God filled him. Why is it that people don't have the Holy Spirit today? Why is it that the Holy Spirit is not poured out on the people of God today? They don't want it. They got these bands, and they got the smoke, and the entertainment, and all of that nonsense in the churches. You know, tricks and monkey tricks, and psychology, and all of this witchcraft. They're not yearning for the Spirit of God. They want money, they want prosperity, they want to fit in with the world. Friends, we need to hunger and thirst and yearn for the Holy Spirit of God. Say, Lord, pour out your Spirit on your people, oh God. Say, Lord, all we need is Jesus. All we need is your Spirit. All we need is your power. He says, it's not by power, it's not by might, it's by the Spirit of the living God. That hearts are changed, that people are saved, that they are delivered, that this world is turned around. It is when the people of God start opening their hearts, start cleansing themselves, start crying out to the Lord and saying, Lord, I need you. I need you, Father, I need you above everything, more than anything. I want you, Lord, I want to do your will. I don't care about other things. I just care about Jesus. I care about the living water of the Holy Spirit of God. I don't care what the world says. I just want thee. Lord, my soul yearns. Not your head, your soul. Have you got that yearning in your soul? Where it's a pang, it's a pain. You say, Lord, oh Lord, please fill me. Just fill me. You know, when you come into that groaning before the Lord, Paul says we don't know rightly what to pray. Romans 8 verse 27. He says, in the same way the Spirit helps our weaknesses, for we do not know how to pray as we should, but the Spirit Himself intercedes for us with groanings too deep for words, and He searches the hearts. He who searches the hearts knows what the mind of the Spirit is, because He intercedes for the saints according to the will of God. We got to groan before the Lord. Cry out and say, Lord, spare your people. Lord, save my children. Lord, save this country. Lord, save the world. Not go into gossiping and looking for trouble with other Christians. We got to yearn for the Spirit of God and cry out to God and say, Lord, pour out your Spirit. Lord, bring peace on this country. Not, Lord, this political party or that party or this money or that money. No. A yearning for the Spirit of God. Say, Lord, help us, please. Cry out to God. And He will hear us. He will answer us. Friends, we got to cry out to God. We got to cry out and say, Lord, fill us. Fill us with a desire for you. Friends, there is no solution for the problems of this world. There's only one solution. That is Jesus. Only Jesus. And Jesus can fix everything. But we've got to get rid of all these other things. Got to chuck out all the psychology and all the nonsense. You know, all the clever stories and all the books and all the media and all these theories. And just get on our knees before Jesus. Say, Lord, save your people. Repent. Go clean out the house. Get rid of all those things that make separate us from God. What is there in your house that God doesn't want? The television or some Xbox or your hobbies or what are those things that you're keeping yourself busy with that are keeping you away from God, that are more important than the Lord, than spending time with the Lord and saying, Father, I yearn for Thee, Lord. I want you more than anything. What is there? What is there that you want more than Jesus? That's your idol. That is what is standing between you and God. Is it your occupation? What is it? God knows. And you know. But friends, we got to seek the Lord more than anything. Why is it that people do not have the Holy Spirit of God? It's because they're not yearning. It's because they're not groaning before the Lord. When you start groaning and crying out before the Lord, He will fill you. Man, He wants to fill you. But if you don't really want it, why should He give it to you? You know, people think that if they just say, Lord, give me this, give me that, give me the other, God's just got to pile it on them. He won't. He'll only give it when we groan for it, when we cry out, when we are serious about Jesus. Say, Lord, I want you more than anything else. He is a jealous God. He does not share space with the devil or with anything else. If Jesus is not coming into reserved space, if your heart and your life is not reserved for Him, He's not going to come in there. He's not going to come and share it with anybody else. He wants all of us, not just a little bit. He wants everything. We got to open the door of our hearts wide and say, Lord, come in. Come fill me with your spirit. Come fill me with your presence. Come fill me with your wisdom. Nothing of me. None of my own things. None of my own thoughts. But only the Spirit of God. Friends, we got to empty all those closets. Get everything out. Open the door. Let the sunshine in. Invite Jesus Christ in and say, Lord, I yearn for you. I want you, Father. I want you. I want your ways, not my ways. People are so full of clever plans and wisdoms, you know. They tell you how things have got to be done and what you've got to say and how you're not going to offend other people. Forget about it, man. Just invite Jesus in. Just throw everything out. Throw it overboard. And invite Jesus in. Get rid of all that extra weight, all those burdens. And invite Jesus in. Say, Lord, swing wide the door of your heart and let Jesus in. Make space for the King. Open the door of your heart. Invite Him in. And He will come in. He says, I stand by the door and I knock. If anyone opens for me, I will come in and have mealtime with him. He wants to come and have mealtime with you. He wants to feed your soul with the best possible. But you've got to open the door for Him. Friends, God wants to give us the very best. But unless we yearn, unless we seek, He says, open your mouth that I can fill it. You've got to do that. Say, Lord, I'm in business. I want you, Lord Jesus. Please, Father, come in. Come in today. Come in to stay. Get rid of all the other things that hinder, that prevent the Spirit of God to work in our lives. Nothing is more important, friends. Only Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, we thank Thee, Lord, for Thy precious Holy Spirit. We thank Thee, Lord, for Thy Spirit indwelling us, O Father, and we pray, O God, for a mighty outpouring of Thy Holy Spirit, Lord, on Thy people, to flow like a river, Lord, to turn this whole world upside down, Father, to bring many people to repentance, Lord, to bring them on their knees before Thee, to know Thee in the power of Thy resurrection, to know God as King, O Lord. O Heavenly Father, I pray, O Lord, that there would be a yearning and a hunger and a thirst among Thy people for Thy Spirit, O God, to fill them, that they will throw out everything, Lord, that makes separation between them and Thee, O God. O Lord, purify us, cleanse us, Lord, help us, Father. Show us whatever it is that is wrong and not pleasing to Thee, O God, that we can get rid of it, Lord. And open the door and invite Jesus in. Lord, fill us with Thy precious Holy Spirit, with Thy power, O God, with Thy words, with Thy wisdom, Father, to flow through us to this dry world, O Lord. Fill us with Thy love and compassion and care for other people, for the whole world, that we will not be quiet, Lord, but cry out and bring people to Thee. Oh, my God, we just pray, Father. Help us, Lord Jesus. Oh, my God. Fill us, Lord, with Thy wisdom, with Thy Spirit. Live in us. Be in us, Father. And work through us to the glory of Thy kingdom, O God, we pray, Father. We yearn for Thee. We seek Thee, Lord, with all our heart, Father. We thank Thee, Father, in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. 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 Dear friends, we got to yearn for the Lord. We got to yearn for Jesus. If we don't have Jesus inside, if we don't have His Spirit in us, then we have nothing. Without Jesus, we can do nothing. We need the power of the Holy Spirit, friends. Not books and knowledge and wisdom. We got to get empty. Say, Lord, fill us, please. We yearn for thee. We yearn for thee, Lord, above all things. Hallelujah. Glory to Jesus. Dear friends, we're going to have communion now for those who are ready and prepared. And we've got to be serious. We've got to be serious about our relationship with God. We've got to be serious when we take communion. Make sure that there's nothing between us and the Lord. No sin, no nothing. No disobedience. No animosity. Nothing. And our mind is clean. You know, a lot of people are walking around with filthy minds. They say, well, my hands are clean, but their minds are dirty. You know, God knows what's going on in our mind. A lot of people have got hatred and animosity towards other people. A lot of people are hating the government. They're blaming other people for what's wrong in their lives. We've got to blame ourselves. Because God determines our lives. We belong to Jesus. We've got to get our sight on Jesus and let him clear us and cleanse us of all iniquity. Hallelujah. Dear friends, we must come to the Lord. Say, Lord, test me, try me, and see if there is in me an evil way. And please, lead me on the everlasting way. Without Jesus, we can do nothing, friends. Without Jesus, we are lost. We need to submit ourselves to God. Come into his presence with fear and trembling. A lot of people don't even know about bowing their knees before God. They've got no reverence. They've got no fear. They've got no respect for God because they don't know God. We've got to come before the Lord with fear. The bondservants of God, they fear him because they know him. He's a terrible God. People who do not fear God are those who don't know him. All these people in the churches that tell you, oh, he's my buddy. They don't know him. They just don't know him. Friends, we've got to serve God with fear and reverence. Come before him and give him the glory and the honor and the praise that is due to him. Jesus is a mighty God. He's King of kings. He's Lord of lords. Serve him with fear and reverence. And as we participate in this communion now, let us do so with respect and make sure that our hearts are pure and clean before the Lord. And if there's something between us and the Lord, go repent first. Or else you eat and drink judgment onto yourself. We cannot sit at the table of the Lord and at the table of the devil. A lot of people, they are serving God part-time. They must make up their minds. When I serve the Lord, serve the Lord. Don't come and sit at the table of the Lord and at the table of the devil. Because then the judgment of God will come on those people. Hallelujah. Heavenly Father, we worship and praise thee, O Lord. Lord Jesus, we thank thee, Lord, for thy body that was given for us, Lord. We thank thee for thy blood that was shed for us, Lord. We thank thee, Lord, that through thee alone we can come to the presence of the Father, Lord. Had it not been for Calvary, had it not been for thy precious blood that was shed for us, there is no way that we could have entry to the Father, Lord, and we come humbly before thee. Lord, we bow down before thee and we adore thee. We thank thee, we praise thee, Lord. Oh my God, we want to be pure and holy before thee, Father. We want to participate in this table, Lord, in remembrance of thee, Lord Jesus, of thy price, the price paid for us, Lord. We want to come and eat of thy body and drink of thy blood, Father, Lord Jesus, that we might have part in thee, that we might have life in thee, Lord. We come and we do so, Lord, with fear and trembling. So, Lord, cleanse us by thy precious blood. O Lord, cleanse us through and through, that we might be worthy vessels, Lord, for thy kingdom. We just come worship thee and praise thee, Lord. We humble ourselves before thee and we pray, O Lord, be magnified in us, Lord, and through us. Lord, let thy spirit dwell in us richly, Lord. Fill us with thy precious Holy Spirit. We humble ourselves before thee, Father. O Lord, we thank thee in Jesus' wonderful name. Amen. Hallelujah. In the night that our Lord Jesus was betrayed, he took bread and he broke it. He said, "This is my body that is broken for you. Eat of this as often as you do in remembrance of me." Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Lord. We bless thy holy name, Lord Jesus. We thank thee, Lord. Hallelujah. And after the supper, the Lord took the cup, and he said, "This is the New Testament in my blood. Drink of this as often as you do in remembrance of me." And we participate of this cup in remembrance of our Lord and our Master. We say, "Lord Jesus, thank thee for thy blood that was shed for us on Calvary, Lord, that we might have life in us. We thank thee, Lord, for thy resurrection power, for thy Holy Spirit given to dwell in us. Fill us, Lord, fill us with thy life, that same Spirit that raised thee from the dead, Lord. O Lord, may we have life in us through our unity with thee, eating thy body and drinking thy blood, O Lord. We just give thee all the glory and all the praises for that. Lord Jesus, we bless thee. We thank thee. Hallelujah." Hallelujah. We thank thee, Lord Jesus. We praise thee, Lord. We give thee all the glory. We give thee all the honor, Lord. O Lord, fill us. Fill us with thyself, O Lord. Inhabit us by thy Spirit, O God. If we do not have thy Spirit, O Lord, then we do not belong to thee, Lord. O Heavenly Father, Lord, if there are people here that are not filled with thy Holy Spirit yet tonight, I pray, Lord, that they open their hearts and that they yearn for thy Spirit so that they can be filled. Because if we do not have the Spirit of Christ, we do not belong to him. O Lord Jesus, we need that Spirit of life that will raise us from the dead, even right now, Lord, to be alive for Christ and dead for the world, alive for the kingdom of God, to do the will of God. Lord, we humble ourselves before thee and we pray, fill us, Father, with thy precious Holy Spirit. Fill us with thy mighty power, O God, that we can go forth in the power of the Holy Spirit, not as men, but as children of God, doing the will of the Father on this world. Lord, we worship and we praise thee, Father, in Jesus' wonderful name we pray. We thank thee in Jesus' name. Amen.